So now that we know what a half cell potential is, or an electrode potential, we're going to look at the overall cell potential. So a standard electrode potential would be the voltage of those half cells as they are hooked up to that standard hydrogen electrode with one molar for the gases and one atmosphere for the gases and one molar for the solutions. You've got to make sure that your other half cells, besides your standard hydrogen electrode, your other half cells are also under standard state conditions. This is where we're going to get tables full of what are called standard reduction potentials, okay? So a cell potential, or standard EMF, remember we have a lot of different ways of doing that, is the sum of the oxidation potential, what is happening at the anode, and the cathode half cell potential, the reduction half cell. These two reactions are happening. An oxidation is happening, a reduction is happening. You come up with the oxidation half cell potential, the reduction half cell potential, those two halves add together to give you a whole. Okay, and that's how we'll do it. So this is the overall cell is the sum of those two guys. Now what we're going to give you, and this is usually the case, it will always be the case in this class, usually the case that these are reported as reduction potentials. It could be that you run across a table that's a bunch of oxidation potentials. Not very common. Usually it's reduction potentials. They just had to choose one or the other and they write them all as reduction reactions. So if you're reading a table and it has a bunch of reduction reactions and you are reading off of it what the potential is, you're reading a reduction potential. If you took that reaction and you flipped it, it would be an oxidation, right? Instead of losing electrons, it's gaining electrons. When you flip the reaction, you change the sign of that half cell potential. So it's easy to get an oxidation potential off of those tables. You reverse the reaction, that's an oxidation, you change the sign of the value, okay? So let's look at an excerpt from a bunch of a table, okay? This is typically how this table works. Look at those numbers. We have the red one there, okay? That red one there is the standard hydrogen electrode, and we see it's written as a reduction, and it's assigned a value of 0 volts. Now, everything above it, if it got hooked up to that hydrogen electrode, we would see those values, and they would all run as reductions, okay? Anything below it would run as a oxidation, because what we will learn and see as we proceed, overall reactions have to have a positive voltage. So those, in order for it to run spontaneously, those things have got to be hooked up in such a way that they will read a positive voltage. All right, so let's see how this is arranged. Reactions at the top are easily reduced. They like to gain electrons. If you think about fluorine on the periodic table, doesn't it really, really like electrons? This is like the primo, most easily reduced substance. So anything up at the top are easily reduced, okay? Reactions down at the bottom are difficult to reduce. Magnesium loves being a plus two charge, loves existing this way. Forcing two electrons on it, he's like, not so much. I don't like that. So things that are at the bottom are difficult to reduce. So that is a standard way of writing these reduction potentials. From the things at the top with very positive values, that means it is easily reduced. Things at the bottom are negative values, meaning they are very difficult to reduce. Conversely, we could say it this way. Reactions at the bottom are easily oxidized. What does that mean? They want to run in this direction. Magnesium really would rather lose its electrons and become 2-. So things down here at the bottom are much more easily oxidized. How would I write that reaction if it was an oxidation? We would write magnesium solid going to magnesium 2+, aqueous, plus 2 electrons. And the potential for that would be 2.37 volts. It wants to run in that direction. So things at the bottom are easily oxidized. So it's the magnesium that's oxidized, not the magnesium 2+ ion, because it's running backwards. Reactions at the top are difficult to oxidize. It is very difficult to take F minus, and we'll put the 2 in there, and say, I want your electrons. You turn into F2, the gas, and let me have your electrons. That F minus is highly electronegative. I don't want you to have my electrons. I don't want to be that way. So the voltage for this reaction would be a negative 2.87. That is how we would read that table. So we see over on the left-hand side what the language they have. If you go down, it's more easily oxidized. We would say that they are good reducing agents. If something wants to be oxidized, it will be a good reducing agent. Things at the top are real easily reduced, so they are really good oxidizing agents, right? If you're easy to reduce, you will oxidize the other guy in there. Now, if you take any two reactions, and I'm just going to pick two, all right? I'm going to pick this reaction here. Why not? Okay, I'm going to pick this reaction here, and I'm going to pick this reaction here. Based upon the way this is rearranged, I can decide how that reaction will run. The things that are above will be reduced. The things that are at the bottom will be oxidized and run backwards. So if I pick any two, I know the one below will be written backwards, will actually run like this if it gets hooked up to this one above. So you pick any two, the one above will be reduced, the one below will be flipped and will be oxidized. Another way you can do this, one of the things that I like to do, is you can make a fish, okay? Here's my little fish. He's always swimming to the right. Doesn't work if he swims to the left. All right, here's my little bug-eyed fish. Let's make him bug-eyed. My little bug-eyed fish, going down are my reactants, all right? Going down on the top side are my products. So if I wanted to write, if I pick two reactions, the overall reaction would be F2 plus AG solid going to, those are my reactants, F minus, and there are two of them, plus AG plus. Now I have to make sure the number of electrons gained and lost are the same, so this one really would have had to have been doubled, and that's what we have here. But you can know that if the fish is swimming to the right, who the reactants and who their products are for your overall reaction. But why is that? One last time. Because this is what we have to be able to read off this table. If you pick any two, this time I'm going to pick this one here. Sorry. I'm going to pick this guy here with this guy here. If you pick any two, you should be able to figure out what's going on. And those might be the two that I have on this next slide. No, I don't have those two. So we'll practice this one together. Okay. We have Br liquid. This one is higher up. The one that's higher up is the one that wants to be reduced. These are reduction reactions, so this one will be as you see it. The one below would be flipped. So my reactants would be the Br2 and the Fe solid. The products would be the Br minus and the Fe2 plus. Now let's see if you can do it. Okay? Which is correct? Would you say that Fe will reduce aluminum 3 plus? Or aluminum will reduce Fe2+. Okay, Fe, so you're looking for reactions that involve Fe and Fe2+ as one half reaction, and Al and Al3+. So I'll help you locate those, right? We've got this guy and this guy. Stop and think about it. Work your way through it mentally and pick one. All right, aluminum will reduce iron 2+. So this is the guy that wants to be written as a reduction. This will be the reduction. This will be the oxidation. Oxidation is the reverse. Al solid going to Al3+ plus 3 electrons. Okay? So the iron and the aluminum are reacting. Iron is the Fe2+ is reduced. The Al is oxidized. So aluminum is reducing the iron 2+. Now if we don't write the reactions and we draw a fish instead, we see that this reacts with that to produce those products. And the overall reaction would be iron 2+, and I'm going to go ahead and multiply by my coefficients that I know I need to multiply in order to have the name, same number of electrons gained as lost, plus 2 aluminum gives me 2 aluminum 3+'s plus 3 Fe solids. So there would be the reaction. Iron is reduced, the iron 2+ is reduced to iron, the aluminum is oxidized. As the aluminum is oxidized, it is reducing the iron. All right, so that's what we have there. Two different ways you could say it. You could either say what I said, aluminum will reduce the Fe2+. We could also say that the Fe2+ is oxidizing the aluminum. Okay, now I have another reaction. Now remember what I told you about overall reactions. You figure out what's oxidized, you figure out what's reduced. You find the reduction reaction, you find the oxidation reaction, which is going to be the reverse of what you see on here. So write the two half reactions, find their half cell potentials, add them together, and tell me what you got for the standard cell potential. Oh, didn't have the answer marked. Thought I did. So what do we have here? We've got magnesium going to magnesium 2+. That's this guy right here. All right, magnesium. Nope, it's not that guy, is it? What's different? It's the reverse of this guy. We have actually, instead, magnesium going to magnesium 2+. That's the reverse reaction. So we're going to have a positive 2.37. And then we find the copper. Now be careful here. I have copper 2+ in two different reactions, don't I? Look over on the product side. Which one is the product I'm looking for? It's this guy. And it's the copper 2+ going to copper solid. So it is this reaction exactly as we see it. So we have a positive 0.34. You add those two things together, and that is how we end up with 2.71 as our answer. Now, it's important that you know that changing the coefficients does not change these values, okay? They don't change with the coefficients. These are standard potentials. The only thing that could change these numbers is if you change the concentration. You have to run it as the aluminum ion's concentration has got to be one molar. The aluminum has to be one molar, and that will give you the standard. So what is going to be the cell potential for these two half reactions? Well, let's find it, okay? We've got the Fe2+ going to Fe solid. Fe2+ going to Fe solid. That's as you see it, so it's a negative 0.45 volts. Then we have the aluminum going to aluminum 3+. That's going this direction. If you reverse the reaction, you change the sign. So it's a positive 1.66 volts. And whatever those add up together to be is what your answer is. Let's see if I can figure this one out. We are subtracting 0.45. I can surely do this math here. 1.2 volts is what we would get. All right, this one is the most challenging, and you might really stop and ponder this. Under standard state conditions, can copper solid, where is copper solid on here? Can copper solid reduce bromine liquid? There's bromine liquid. I helped you find them. What did you say? Did you say yes? You would be correct. The Br will be reduced because it's above. Things above are reduced and run as you see them. Anything down here can do the reduction of Br, and copper is below it. So this would be reacting with copper solid to produce those two products right there. The thing being reduced is above, and then that is how these tables are arranged. Now, finish by saying, remember, this is how we will do it. We will have the reductions. There will be reduction half reactions. We will put the most easily reduced at the top with high reduction potentials. All right, the ones at the bottom will have very low reduction potentials because of the way this table is arranged. If you run around looking at tables on the internet, you might find things that are arranged differently, but I will always present them to you this way. All right, for a metal to be soluble in an acid, some metals are. To be soluble in an acid, it must be oxidized by H+. And we'll talk about that little asterisk there in just a minute, that star, because there's a qualifier here. So I'm going to have this as one of the electrodes, and I want to know which metal could be dissolved. So I want to know which metals can be oxidized. Well, if this one's running as a reduction, we have copper, the metal, up here, and we have aluminum, the metal, down here. Which way is it going to go? Well, it's going to be the aluminum. Hydrogen can force this guy to be oxidized and give you those products when it happens, okay? If this is running as a reduction, anything below it can run as an oxidation. So what's happening? I take that aluminum as a metal, and I place it in a solution that contains H+, it is going to turn into the aluminum ion. Now, it's not balanced as I see it here, but it is going to be turned into the aluminum ion as the hydrogen ends up becoming hydrogen gas. If we want to write a good balanced reaction, we can look at those two half reactions and say, okay, we need the same number of electrons gained as lost, so I'm going to take this reaction times 3, and I'm going to take this reaction and flip it. Okay, so it's actually going to be aluminum solid going to Al3+, plus 3 electrons. I flipped it because it has to be oxidized, and then times 2. And that will give me the overall balanced reaction of 6H+, plus 2 aluminum solid going to 3H2 gas plus 2 aluminum 3+. So there is the overall reaction of it, and aluminum can easily dissolve. So anytime you can take a metal ion, put it in an acid, any metal below it is going to be soluble. But it doesn't have to necessarily just be a metal below it, okay? Here comes the star, and you can't, that isn't the star, sorry. We just did all what that says, and I'll let you see it there. But the star there says, it could be that you have an anion above it. Now, this is just a partial table, but somewhere up pretty high is the ion NO3-. Okay, somewhere up there is NO3-, and so we can say, hey, if I had nitric acid, a whole lot more metals would be soluble in nitric acid, and it's one of those that we use a lot to dissolve metals when maybe a hydrochloric acid wouldn't work. All right. Cell potential, if it runs with a positive cell potential, it's going to run spontaneously. We learned what kind of magnitude of delta G and K we'd have for spontaneous reactions, so we're going to see that all three of these things are connected to cell potential in our next lesson.